I'm going to come from a verse that I don't even need to read in. Mm-hmm. You don't need to read it either. And it's John 3:16. Come on now, say with me now. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God, we thank you, we love you, we adore you, we lift you up, and we give you praise, honor, and glory. We thank you for your word today, oh Father God. We ask that you bless us because we came out no matter what. We understand that it is days like this, oh Father God, that we are moving ahead, oh God.
Yes,
that the oil is not missing from our lamp, God. When you're saying, who shall I send, Lord, we answered and said, here I am, send me. And we're glad to be on the front line this morning, lifting you up, praising you, oh Father God, Lord. The race is not for the swift, but for those who endure to the end. So we're thanking you here today. We love you. We lift you up. And we give you praise, honor, and the glory. And in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
I like to pick Bible verses that we all know and pick them apart, because sometimes we get our Bible understanding for what we hear. Which is okay, but it's not the best thing to do. I have a joke. These two friends were debating. One says, I know more Bible than you. The other one said, oh, no, you don't. And he says, I bet you $100 you don't know Bible than me. He says, okay, let's go. I'll take that bet. So the friend said, okay, I want you to recite the Lord's Prayer. The other guy starts, okay, I can do that. He says, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. The other one says, that is amazing. Here's the $100. And even though that seemed like two stupid people, it's because he didn't know the word himself. He knew for what somebody told him. All he knew was what he heard when he was a child. So you could ask him anything. That's all he knew about the Bible. And many of us are walking around the same way. We only have what we learned when we went to Sunday school. We only have what somebody taught us. We feel that because we can memorize and quote the Bible, we know what the Lord is talking about. And I tell you, it's not sufficient. In this Bible verse, John 3:16, there's a background, and it's about Nicodemus. And Nicodemus, he was a Pharisee. That means he was well-learned. He was a leader of Israel. Yet still, he didn't know what God was about. So it's not just us little people who might not know everything that God said. It's people who stand up above too. They can read books. They can study. They can have great scholarship. But have they had a true connection with the Lord? Just by this man's name, you knew that he was out of order. His name was Nicodemus. Nico is the name Nike. Nike is the name of a Greek goddess, a woman. Nike is a woman. And she was the god of victory for the Greeks. And they named this Jew the name of a Greek goddess. It's like having the Pope call Beelzebub. He's sitting up there saying, I'm a holy man, but my name is Greek goddess. It's like me having a name, I'm Pastor Venus. It's the same thing. And here comes the man with the pagan name, and he's proud of it, Nicodemus, coming at night to Jesus. You see, sometimes we can be labeled by what people say. We can be caught up in what people do. People can put a name on us, and we don't even know what the name is. But somehow this man, for all his learning, did not know what Jesus was about. And he came to Jesus at night. You see, sometimes during the day with somebody else, but at night he knew he needed Jesus, and he had enough sense to at least find his ignorant way with his wrong name self to the Lord. And I ask you right now, if you got things that are wrong in your life, you don't need for everybody else to see it. You just got to find your way to Jesus somehow. And if you find your way to Jesus, that's the problem. Sometimes when we get our way to Jesus, we think he's going to fix the world. But Jesus had something for Nicodemus that he didn't realize nor expect. And Nicodemus says to Jesus, he says, I see that you are a man of God because you couldn't do these things, but God is with you. See, that's our problem, you see, because we want to look at those who look like God is with them, and God is not with these people any less than God is with you. So what, they can prophesy, so what, they can preach, so what, they can sing. That doesn't mean that God is more with them than you. So what, they can bring miracles. That does not mean that God is with them, because I've always said, Jesus said to them, they said to Jesus, in the end, haven't we done miracles in your name? Jesus said, get thee hence, I've never known you. So it's not that people can do miracles. It's not that people have gifts that makes them godly. It's whether or not they know the Lord. And Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again.
Yes.
Blew this man's mind. And what was God saying to him fundamentally? He says to him finally, is that for God so loved the world, but he gave his only begotten son. You see, because Nicodemus believed that it was because of Abraham. He was a Jew. They believed that Abraham is our father. Therefore, we can't be wrong. And many of us are looking at what happened in the past and who we believe, and whether we're Seventh-day Adventists and following that person, whether we're Jehovah's Witness and following that person, whether we're Pentecostal and following Azusa Street, whether we're a Jew and following this and that. And Jesus has no time for them in that mess, because it's not what a man told you. You can't say, I'm a Baptist, I believe in immersion baptism, therefore I'm going to heaven. He ain't got time for that. You can't say, I'm a Pentecostal and I speak in tongues, therefore I know I'm holy. He doesn't have time for you either. Mm-hmm. He set this man straight. And that's the problem with us and Jesus, because we think that Jesus is there to co-sign our madness. We think that he's there to validate our world. We think that he's there to prove to everybody else that we're good, but he's not. The Jews today still believe that their liberation is going to come from a king like David, who's going to put everybody down and put them on top. And they're wrong. We believe the same thing, that the Lord is going to fix them for doing me wrong. Lord, they threw me out the window. Lord, they punched me in my eye. They fired me. They did me wrong. They stole my car. We have all these petitions against people, and we say, well, God's going to get them. I do it too. So it's not just you.
Yeah.
But see, God ain't got time for that, because Jesus told them furthermore that God loved the world. That means everybody who did you wrong, God loved them. That means that everybody who did you wrong can snuggle up to Jesus today, and you got to deal with it. Because if God didn't love them despite their badness, how do you think he's going to love you despite their badness? Because if he's fickle, if he pick and chooses, he is no God. He's just someone who acts upon a whim. He's not that. He's absolute. And it's hard for a Jew to hear that it's not about you. It's not about you. It's about what God says that we have to do. Sometimes walking with the Lord is like being a bush. And we think that God is going to come and say, oh, what a nice bush. What a nice tree. What a nice plant we are. No, he's not. Jesus said, don't come. Don't think I came to bring peace, but a sword. So he comes to lop some things off us. Huh? We got somebody we really love, they gone. Huh? Come on now. We got a job we really want, it's gone. We got our health that we really depend upon, it's gone. He's lopping, he's taking things off of you. He's cutting things down, because the first commandment says that he is a jealous God, and he shall not have no mate. He shall not have no job. He's not going to have no car. He's not going to have your happiness. He's not going to have your culture or your religion before him. He's not going to have it. He is going to take everything from you and strip you down naked, because the first thing that Adam and Eve did when they sinned is they sought to cover themselves up to make themselves look good. But Job said, naked I came into this world, and naked I am coming out. You don't have any right to hold upon anything, and God does not owe you anything. We got the thing mixed up. It's like we think that God is going to stop his move in the universe just to stop it and make us feel good. You got the thing all mixed up. You must run after God. You must ask him, what should I do next? If you want peace in your life, you got to say, Lord, it's wrong in my life, but show me what to do. And sometimes we don't want to hear what he's going to say to you. That's why sometimes we don't pray with honesty. Because what he's going to tell you? Leave him alone. What he's going to tell you? Put it down. What he's going to tell you? Quit. What he's going to tell you? Suffer. And we don't want to do those things. We want to be like children. And every child that we know wants ice cream for breakfast. And that's what we want, like children. But we don't want to grow up and deal with the hardships of life. And he's telling Nicodemus, it's not what you think. You can't come and tell God how it's supposed to be. You're sneaking around trying to find Jesus. And he's right here in your face. And you don't see what the situation is. And you see, because the Jews believe that because Abraham took Isaac up to the mountain and was going to slay him, oh, they're godly. Let me tell you, you can't follow Abraham. Because today, Abraham would be in jail. Number one, Abraham had all these concubines that, and Sarah gave him one. Number two, Abraham threw out Hagar and Ishmael. He'd be no good, no count today. So we can't follow him because as time changes, the evaluation of a man changes. But as time changes, God never changes. He's not a man that he should lie, nor should he repent. And if you hold on to things that are passed away and dead, it doesn't profit you today. You can't believe in Abraham today. You can't believe in Isaac today. You can't believe in Jacob today. That's why he sent Jesus to show them that there is no other father but God. It's not Abraham. It's not Pentecost. It's not Judaism. It's not Jehovah's Witness. It's not what you feel. It's not what your emotions. It's not what you lost. The question is, do you know who God is in your life? And he said he sent love. And we think love is like going to make everything all right in our lives. No, love is a struggle. You say you're going to love somebody, you signed up for some trouble. If you want to have a peaceful life, stay by yourself and live in a cave. Nobody won't bother you. But if you step out and fall in love with somebody, it ain't nothing but pain and heartache. I don't care if you love a dog, you got to clean up some mess. I don't care if you love a child, they're going to drive you crazy and act a fool. I don't care if you love a man or woman, they're going to do things that you can't imagine. They're going to do things to you that you wouldn't mind wearing one of those striped suits and sitting behind the window with the plexiglass. You're not going to mind that because it seems that bad. And the same thing is with God. It's not about you. And why? It's because it's about humility. And if you got that humility where you're going to say, Lord, I understand that I don't care what everybody else did. And I don't care that things are wrong in my life. I don't care that I'm headed towards my own crucifixion. I don't care that I've been crucified right now, that I'm going to stand and trust you. And the minute you begin to trust the Lord, everything changes. You see, the enemy is going to tell you, you're going to die.
Yeah.
You need them. You got to have this job. You got to have this car. Huh? She look good. She don't look good. Mm-hmm. He got bad breath. All these things we make judgments upon. But when we choose what God says, and it's hard to give it up. It's hard to give up what we value because we're still believing that Abraham is our father. That what men pass down to us are important. And that's how we base our entire lives. But if we base our life on the love of God, you're going to be surprised. All of a sudden, you're going to be like Peter for one instant, walking on water. All of a sudden, even if a snake bites you, it don't even bother you. You see, there are people right now who are going through things that we think are terrible. But they're dealing with it like it ain't nothing. But those of us who believe that what a man told us, as soon as what that man told us is not true, and we bet our whole life on it, we realize we just hold on to straws and we're drowning. But God is saying to you today, forget what you've been told. It ain't no good to you. Forget what you're holding on to. It's not going to happen. He's saying you even got the wrong kind of name on you, but I'm going to give you a new name. That's why he renamed people. He's saying forget all those things that you have done, all those things you believed in. He's saying furthermore, there's nobody coming to save you. There's nobody coming to give you nothing. There's no person with a bag full of money and a nice figure showing up to rescue you from your situation. It's not going to happen. He's saying you have to put your heart in the right place. He wants you to just be obedient. And he says, if you just believe, you shall have life and even have it more abundantly. That's why the apostles who were cowards in the past, once they believed Jesus, they were able to withstand everything, and they had power from on high. And they didn't have power to make themselves look good. Hear me now. Jesus didn't have power to make himself look good. They had power to show just how good God is. And how good God is that he enables you to overcome. And sometimes we gotta look at this life as being a soldier. That's a type of love, because if you believe that you're a soldier, you don't mind going to battle. A lot of us is not going to a shooting gallery. No, we're not. They're shooting, we're running, right? But when you're a soldier, what do? You pull out your M16, that's right. You don't care if you don't have no flak jacket, and you run to the sounds of battle, and that's what Christians do. They have that kind of life that they're ready to fight the battle, and all of us are running around like rats, running around the night trying to find something that might work good for us. But when you have that soldier power that's already within you, that nerve, that strength, that you believe that your life was meant to be a sacrifice. That's why soldiers get awards. They give them pieces of cloth upon their shirt, and that's enough for them to risk their lives. But God is saying, I got something greater for you than that. I got something greater for you than a ribbon on your chest. I got something better for you than a symbol upon your shoulder. He says that he's going to give you a name, a new name. If you read Revelation, he has gifts for those churches who get what they're supposed to do. And if a soldier can go up there and throw his life away for people who want to jack up other people, why can't we devote part of our lives to Christ? Because we believe what Abraham told us. We believe what another man told us. And God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Because he wants you to believe in him. He don't care if you are a devil worshiper, he loves you. He don't care if you're a Republican, he loves you. He don't care if you're liberal, left wing, whatever. He loves you. Yes. And that's what makes us mad sometimes. Because, you see, when we believe in other men, we start to hate. Yes. That's how you know you're wrong. Mm-hmm. But when you love the Lord, you begin to look inside. You want to be born again. You want to change your mind. You begin to see what's wrong with you.
Yes.
And when you start working with wrong with you, the world changes for you. You got no time to be fighting with other people. In fact, you're not even mad at them. Sometimes your heart goes out to them because you know they're not getting their own self right. Jesus is saying, get your own self right. Mm-hmm. He loves the world because he wants you to believe so that you can have something greater. Greater than a ribbon, greater than a symbol on your shoulder, which will give our lives away for today. Mm-hmm. He's saying to us, he has a greater life for us.
Yes.
It's a life of power. Mm-hmm. Lastly, he said, my favorite Bible verse is that you can do this. Don't be afraid, because he has not given you a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. Father, we thank you. We lift you up. We give you praise, honor, and glory. I'm asking God that you bless every person on the sound of my voice, Lord. I want you to have them believe, oh Father God, that you are Lord, oh God. I want them all to have everlasting life, and more than that, have it more abundantly. I want them to be able to stamp out blindness. I want them to be able to stamp out hunger. I want them to be able to step on the serpent's head. I want them to overcome loss, oh Father God. I want them to be able to overcome poverty, oh Father God. I want them to be overcome anything that's been dogging their heels, oh Father God. I want them to understand they can't get this from a person, but they can only get it from you. Lord, we love you. We thank you because you first love us. And in your holy name we pray. Amen. 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 Amen.